Mariko Yashida continues to discover new secrets on Kirisaki thanks to her yokai heritage in Marvel's comic book series inspired by Japanese mythology, Demon Days. In the third issue, Cursed Blood, Mariko makes new friends and enemies as her twisted sister Ogin gears up for war. Just what does she want from Mariko?
In this video, we'll dive into the most recent issue of Demon Days and explore how it uses Japanese mythology to create a new take on familiar Marvel characters. Hey there, Japan fans, I'm Kay, and if this is your first time clicking play, welcome to my channel, Eat, Pray, Anime. Hit subscribe and ring the bell to continue exploring with me the religious history and culture behind our favorite Japanese media.
Marvel's five-issue prestige series, Demon Days, features story and illustration by Stormbreaker artist Peach Momoko, writing by yokai expert and star translator Zack Davisson, and lettering by the talented Ariana Maher.
If you saw my last two videos on the Demon Days series, then you already know I'm obsessed with the mix of Japanese folklore and Marvel superhero mythos that is the Momokoverse. And if you missed those two episodes, you can find the link to them up above. Before we dive in, a special shout out goes out to Jared, my local comic book store owner at Heroes Your Mom Threw Out in Elmira, New York, for helping me to nab my favorite variant cover. The comic is available to read immediately online, but please, if you can, use the link in the description below to find your nearest local comic book shop and support them by buying a hard copy. It's the only way to get your hands on these beauties outside of eBay. Buckle your seatbelts, friends, it's spoiler time.
In the previous issue, Demon Days Mariko, we learned that intense schoolgirl Mariko, who will totally cut you if you try any shit, is no ordinary shoujo. She discovers that she's the child of an oni, a gruesome creature of Japanese legend. Mariko was rescued as a small child from the mysterious Kirisaki Mountain, where her mother was killed. Mariko's adoptive granny turns out to be descended from sorcerers, and her maid Kuroki is a spy working for Ogin, an oni with blood ties to Mariko. When Kuroki refuses to turn Mariko over to Ogin, she's kidnapped, and Mariko sets off for the Misty Mountains with her mother's tanto knife and red jaw armor to find answers for herself.
Cursed Blood opens with a new character, Reina, a schoolgirl hidden away in the mountains, conducting experiments on her pet poisonous spider.
Oh, who's a little fluffy strawberry?
From little clues like her pink sailor suit collar, trendy spider bomber jacket, and cerulean bag, it's clear that Reina is based off of Marvel's Earth 65 Ghost Spider, aka Spider-Gwen, aka Gwen Stacy. Now we have two Spider-Verse characters in Demon Days, Spider-Gwen and Venom. Obligatory Spider-Man No Way Home reference. Also, go check out the new trailer for the animated film sequel, Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse. You can thank me later.
Anyways, Reina proves that she's not just a STEM geek with a sick literary reference to 17th century haiku master Matsuo Basho.
Kumo nani to, ne o nani to naku, aki no kaze. Spider, oh spider, with what voice, what song do you sing on the autumn wind? With a vial of deadly spider venom, Reina heads out into the forest. At the same time, Mariko makes her way up the mountain. Her bright yellow cloak is reminiscent of the dress of Granny Yashida and her ancestor, the great sorceress Juju, aka X-Men Jubilee. Mariko has the feeling she's being watched, and she's suddenly ambushed by two yokai, Toraji and Ocho. Toraji is clearly based on Brotherhood of Evil Mutants member and nemesis of Wolverine, Sabretooth. And the blue-skinned Ocho is a dead ringer for mutant criminal mastermind and shapeshifter Mystique.
In the pages that follow, we get a much better sense of artist and storyteller Peach Momoko's talent for action and horror.
As Toraji squeezes the life out of Mariko with one colossal hand, the mythical wolf Logan jumps out of the brush to defend her. Mariko finally has a moment to catch her breath and launch a counteroffense. She chomps down on Toraji's hand, and once she's released, an ominous red aura billows out around her. Her eyes turn red, and Mariko cries out, "I remember." Something of her bloody past has come back to her and fills her with newfound power. She draws her tanto knife and slashes Toraji's eyes out. She absolutely owns Toraji, and the red aura around her takes the form of her mother, the beautiful oni from her memories. Mariko ties on the red jaw armor that is her birthright and lets loose an attack augmented by the red energy around her. Toraji is down for the count, and Ocho escapes back to Ogin's compound, while Logan and Reina approach an exhausted Mariko. Meanwhile, in the woods, Ogin explains to a young yokai named Halbo that Kuroki has betrayed their family and needs to be punished. Ocho, who Ogin refers to by the nickname Bluebird, reports in and promises not to fail to capture Mariko a second time. On the other side of the woods, Reina and Mariko get to know each other better. Reina explains that she has a vendetta against yokai, particularly Ocho, for killing her parents. Suddenly, Kuroki appears at the door, and the wolf Logan and Reina attack her. They've seen through the shape-shifting disguise of Ocho, and Reina goes in for the kill using her yo-yo string, which is coated in spider venom. Ocho transforms into a crow and launches her own attack. Mariko tries to resist Ocho and convince Reina not to kill her so that she can get answers. But spotting an opening, Ocho breaks free. Mariko cuts off Ocho's arm, leaving her to bleed out. With her final words, Ocho explains that she and Mariko are not so different. They're both cursed by their blood. And when an oni drinks yokai blood, as Ogin likes to do, they gain power. With her vendetta fulfilled, Reina parts ways with Mariko, gifting her last vial of spider venom. Teleporting yokai Kuya, aka Nightcrawler, reports back to Ogin that Ocho was slain at the hands of Mariko. Ogin decides to take the kid gloves off and bring Mariko in by force. She dispatches two new characters, Sosuke and Ororo, to bring her in. On their way through the forest, Sosuke and Ororo share a conversation that hints at their secret identities and their own hidden motives.
If you're a fan of Japanese mythology, you may have picked up on visual references to Sosuke and Ororo's hidden identities scattered throughout the comics.
Sosuke's outfit clearly mimics that of Marvel's version of the Norse god of thunder, Thor, while Ororo's name, dark skin, and white hair are recognizable as characteristics of the X-Men who control the weather, Storm. But as Sosuke and Ororo leave the dilapidated temple that Ogin uses as her hideout, they silently pass by two statues of the Shinto kami, or deities of wind and thunder, Fujin and Raijin. If you recall in the first issue, Raijin is depicted wielding a hammer. Thanks to my friend Jacob for spotting that clue. I won't go into more detail here because I have a sneaking suspicion that we'll see a lot more of these kami in issue 4, aptly named Rising Storm.
Like all the issues of Demon Days preceding it, Cursed Blood ends with a few new additions to the Yokai Files.
In this case, the legendary inspirations for the characters Toraji and Ocho are explained by Zack Davisson. Toraji is revealed to be based on the Nue, one of Japan's most ancient and mysterious monsters. According to yokai expert Michael Dylan Foster, the Nue, whose name can be literally translated as nightbird or scaly thrush, probably started out as a bird in Chinese folklore. This is how the Nue is portrayed in the earliest available Japanese records, the Kojiki and the Manyoshu poetry collection. Whenever the bird's strange cry was heard at night and black clouds floated over the palace, ritual specialists were called upon to perform purification ceremonies to ward off any bad juju like illness and nightmares. The species of bird identified as the origin of the Nue legend today is called Toratsugimi. And yes, this Tora, meaning tiger, is the same Tora in Toraji, aka Sabretooth's name. By the 13th century, when the Heike Monogatari, or the Tale of the Heike, was completed, the Nue had transformed into a chimerical beast, meaning that it became a hybrid creature made from many other different creatures' parts. In this case, the Nue is said to have the head of a monkey, the torso of a tanuki, the legs of a tiger, and a snake for a tail. Other accounts mention body parts from cats, foxes, and chickens. In the Tale of the Heike, Emperor Konoe notices a black cloud floating toward his palace, and he soon falls ill and is tormented by nightmares. He calls upon the legendary samurai Minamoto no Yorimasa to defeat the encroaching evil spirit. Yorimasa shoots the Nue out of the cloud and disposes of the body by placing it in a boat and floating it down the Kamo River. Several villages claim that that legendary Nue washed up on their shores. How much does the Nue really have to do with Toraji's powers, based on what little we know about them? If I'm being honest, not much. But relatively speaking, there aren't a lot of scary tiger-related yokai to draw upon in the first place. So why not pick the Nue? The yokai that the shapeshifter Ocho is based on is called a Bake-karasu. Like other types of bakemono yokai, the Bake-karasu is a shape-shifting animal, in this case, a crow. As Zack Davisson explains, in Japanese folklore, animals that live preternaturally long lives gain supernatural powers. Collectively referred to as henge, these transformed animals can shapeshift into many forms and often have other powers as well. Peach Momoko's character sheets show that Ocho, who shares a name with a species of blue crow, has a tattoo on her back in the shape of a yatagarasu, another legendary crow with three legs. A shapeshifting crow yokai is a perfect fit for the mutant shapeshifter Mystique, who also goes by the name Raven Darkholm.
In my last video on Demon Days, I shared my theory that the leader of the yokai, Ogin, is the Momokoverse version of the Marvel character Silver Samurai.
This makes perfect sense since Mariko Yashida is related to both Silver Samurais in the comics, and she herself becomes the Scarlet Samurai.
I have it on good authority from sources inside Marvel that I'm onto something. But Cursed Blood has left me with even more questions. Why is Mariko's Oni heritage so unique?
Why is her mother so beautiful and human-like in contrast with all the myths about hideous Oni? And why do Mariko's latent powers manifest in a sort of red energy aura around her that can take different shapes? Think about it, we've seen an image of her mother, a sword, and in the teaser for the next issue, red horns and outlined eyes. My current theory is that Mariko's powers, her tanto knife, and her jaw armor tie her back to the legendary hero we met in issue 1, Sai. Remember that Sai, based on the psychic energy-wielding mutant Psylocke, helped to defeat the demon serpent Orochi in the temple that Ogin now lives in, and she helped mend relations between the villagers of Kirisaki Mountain and the local Oni community. Sai was good friends with the immortal wolf Logan, who Mariko remembers without ever having met him before. Sai also wields a sword surrounded by energy, in her case purple, and sports a red scarf around her neck that seems to echo how Mariko wears the red jaw armor as a necklace. But how could Sai and Mariko be related? Could Sai and Hulk Maru have become more than friends? A human marrying into an Oni clan might make sense considering that Hulk Maru and Chibi Abomination look monstrous, but Mariko's mother appears mostly human. There's one more visual clue. This rendition of Mariko unsheathing her blade with a red energy aura forming distinct shapes around her is incredibly reminiscent of classic illustrations of Psylocke with her signature psychic butterfly pattern and energy blade. If I'm right, Ogin and Mariko are not only siblings, but both descendants of the legendary warrior Sai. And taking my theory one step further, I think that Ogin's katana, which we've seen just a few times wrapped in bandages and decorated with capsule-shaped things that I think might be vials of blood, will be revealed to originally be Sai's katana. That would make Ogin and Mariko's blades a matching set. The short tanto blade could even be part of the original blade's tip that snapped off. I'm just spitballing here, but we haven't seen the sharp end of Ogin's katana yet, so it's possible. Needless to say, I am super excited for the release of the next issue, Rising Storm, which comes out on December 15th.
What role do the undercover kami play in Mariko's story? And what mysterious past do Mariko and Ogin share? Share your predictions in the comments down below, and don't forget to check out my videos on issues 1 and 2 to get caught up above. That's all for now. As always, thank you for watching, and don't forget to eat, pray, and watch anime.